Today on Spotlight with Katie, I have somebody who has a lot of experience, an experience that is something that I have never come across. A man who's born in Kolkata, an NIFT pass out from Hyderabad. Over 10 years of experience in creating scapes into masterpieces. With me, I have Abhishek and a very interesting story that you guys will be surprised about. Hi Abhishek.
Hi.
So, tell me the entire journey of how you started.
I came into design by accident. Mm-hmm. It was not in my career plan, you know, how going to high school we have career plans and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't even know about design studies. But, honest to God, I had no idea that it's something called design studies back in 1990.
Okay.
So it was my mom who was pretty perceptive about what I'm good at.
Mm-hmm.
Other than studies, I was pretty good in studies. And she asked me to take, you know, the NIFT entrance exam. Mm-hmm. And frankly, I just went there to check out girls, right? So somehow I just got through. Mm-hmm. Without knowing the first thing about design.
Okay.
And I got into design precisely because I knew nothing about it.
Okay.
I have always been the type who takes a less traveled path or something that he doesn't know about and then explores it.
Okay.
And makes the journey itself into a destination.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I studied fashion and I worked in fashion, I worked in packaging design, product design, graphics.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, design is a world of exploration and you are only restricted by what you are willing to learn.
Correct.
It's about developing your creative abilities and your skill set.
Mm-hmm.
And skill is something that I feel we should all keep learning and developing throughout our life.
Mm-hmm.
And so I kept doing that.
Mm-hmm.
And I reached a point in my career where, you know, I was missing working with my own hands, creating with my own hands.
Mm-hmm.
The job was stressful and I always found, you know, relief in creation.
Mm-hmm.
So I started with a hobby of creating jewelries and stuff with old watches.
Mm-hmm.
Because I've always been intrigued and fascinated by old watches with the little fine mechanisms. All those parts working together, it's just mesmerizing.
Okay.
How they come together and they work together.
Mm-hmm.
And to measure something which is totally imaginative. There is no physical entity called it. It's not imagination.
Mm-hmm.
And we haven't created something as elegant,
mm-hmm,
a device to measure something totally imaginative.
Okay.
Right? So that's my fascination with watches. And in the history of watchmaking,
mm-hmm,
humanity is best in their artistic ability, fine arts, I mean,
mm-hmm,
as well as technological abilities,
mm-hmm,
came together in watches.
Okay.
The designs of the cases, their dials, the hands, there has been absolute masterpieces that people have made. You know, unknown artists, unknown engravers, unknown metalsmiths have made them.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, there have been many watchmakers who created absolute masterpieces.
Correct.
So, for me, as a very ecologically sensitive, environmentally sensitive designer, it kind of hurt me to see all these beautiful watches, these metals getting scrapped and wasted.
Wow.
Right? And it was pretty important for me to kind of take them, revive them, restore them and reinvent them,
mm-hmm,
into something that people will start to cherish and pass on to their next generation.
Okay.
Something of real value and not just imaginative value set by our sense of ego.
Mm-hmm.
Something with a real history.
Okay.
So that was my motivation and still remains my primary motivation.
Okay.
So I created Absent based on these principles,
mm-hmm,
that everything, at least 95% of everything I use is recycled. Every piece has to be unique, absolutely one of a kind.
Mm-hmm.
There are of course different percentages of uniqueness that I use of these. Some pieces are absolutely one of a kind. There are,
mm-hmm,
no second piece of it.
Correct.
Some pieces where, you know, how in jewelry, certain parts of it is repeated,
mm-hmm,
but every single piece has got its own story.
Alright. So, the minute you say somebody passed out from NIFT, majority of the perception is the fashion designer.
Right.
you have stepped into the world of accessories and jewelry,
right,
which of course a lot of people also do, but then you're further classified into something which is unique.
Right.
How did this whole idea start? What was the first time that you created and what was that piece? How did you think, okay, this is something I want to now take forward?
I did not start thinking I'll create a piece.
Okay.
I started thinking that I'll tell a story. You know, my first piece, and I say this everywhere, my first piece was a watch that was gifted to my mom by my grandfather.
Oh, okay.
And my grandfather had passed away a long time back.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, like every child, she misses him dearly.
Mm-hmm.
And this watch was something that my grandfather gifted her when she excelled in her studies, in her exams. So it was a very, very important part of her growing up, of her sense of accomplishment, of a sense of love.
Mm-hmm.
And this watch was not working for the longest time.
Okay.
So it was just kept in a corner of her drawer.
Mm-hmm.
So I asked her if she can give it to me and if I can do something with it, you know, creatively. I had no idea what it would
do.
So what was important to me was that connection, that mm-hmm. emotional connection between me, my mother and my grandfather.
Correct.
And I turned that first piece into like a pendant that she can wear again.
Oh.
Right. So through that one single piece, mm-hmm. three generations of our family
got connected.
Yeah. So the object was not important.
Mm-hmm.
If I made a really stunning looking pendant or a ring or what I designed with it, see, the academic part of design was not important.
Correct.
What was important was the emotional part of design.
Correct.
And design, I have always believed, should connect emotion.
Mm-hmm.
There are, of course, I mean, there is design everywhere. And there are, of course, designs which are utilitarian designs,
mm-hmm.
chairs, tables, you know. But at the core of every design, part of every design,
mm-hmm.
if it can connect with its user,
mm-hmm.
with its, you know, the final client, in an emotional level,
mm-hmm.
then there is no looking back. There is no taking away the value of that design, of that object.
Correct.
So from just an object, it becomes a part of it.
Okay.
And I feel that every designer wants to do that, mm-hmm. dreams to do that, or should.
Okay, so when you say you started with the watch, then looking around, I see you use a lot of radio, you use a lot of other technical stuff as well. Have you traveled a lot to gather these kind of pieces? Have you made this like an intentional move? Okay, I want to collect a lot of historic pieces and then bring it back to the world again?
It's not a calculated move,
mm-hmm.
because I'm a very spontaneous, emotional designer.
Okay.
I do things that connect with me.
Uh-huh.
I tell stories that I want to tell.
Mm-hmm.
I express my thoughts that I feel strongly about.
Mm-hmm.
And hence, none of this that you see
mm-hmm.
Has been planned or calculated.
Okay.
I love the radios. I mm-hmm. genuinely love them because they have so much characters.
Correct.
You look around our current, or go back even 20 years, the current music systems. See, music is something deeply emotional.
Correct.
It connects with us in a very, very emotional level.
Mm-hmm.
All sorts of music.
Mm-hmm.
Why is the music player so cold and so devoid of any emotion? Just a black box or a black bar.
Right.
Why is it so? You know, that was my thought. And when I look at these vintage radios, they are so unique. They make you feel so warm and fuzzy.
Correct.
And nostalgic.
Mm.
They have so much character. And those are very strong emotions that it evokes in.
Correct.
In our daily life,
mm-hmm.
everything has become very portable and accessible, which is great, right?
Mm.
You don't need to carry a bulky music player.
Correct.
You just carry something which is invisible to listen to music. But then you also sometimes want to sit down and feel the emotion and not just listen to music. You want to create that ambience.
Right?
That is very important. That is very important part of design. The rest is already there.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And technology will keep going forward. Things will keep getting smaller.
Mm-hmm. Right?
But then what about feelings and emotions and ambience and environment? What about feeling a tactile connection with the music and not just the auditory connection to the music? See, we have five senses and design should appeal to as many of them, if not all of them. So that's why these objects which were created when people had time, you know, entire families came together to listen to a radio program.
Correct.
Yeah. Entire neighborhoods came together to listen to radio.
Correct.
And I keep listening to these stories over and over again. I see when people look at these videos, their eyes watering up because it evokes that nostalgic emotion in their mind when they used to sit on their grandfather's lap to listen to a radio singer.
Totally.
Right?
Totally.
See, that is the story. That is what I collect. I don't collect objects. I don't collect vintages. I collect stories. So whatever connects with me, wherever I go, I go to places again to have an experience. I don't go somewhere to look for things.
Okay.
We find each other. As long as that connection is authentic and genuine and honest, we will keep finding each other.
So which is that one piece that you feel, wow, thank God I came to this place and thank God I found this piece?
There are a lot.
Must be.
I have collected hundreds of videos, I've collected thousands of watches, right? I've collected skulls and insects, right? And I've turned them all into something that meant something to me and connected with someone else. You know, something that people have said they are beautiful, right? And you know, beauty doesn't have a definition. Someone can see beauty in the bird and someone can see beauty in the skull of the bird when the bird is dead. Beauty doesn't die with something that stops breathing. And beauty continues.
Wow. Picking up watches is fine, picking up radios is fine. Who goes and collects skulls and birds? Please, how do you even go there?
So, see, when you break down any object into the language of design, you're talking about lines, forms, colors, textures.
Correct.
A bird has that, when it's dead, its skull has that. Right? So to a designer who is looking for expression, who is looking for stories, it doesn't have to be a living, breathing, or beautiful, like traditionally defined as beautiful object.
Okay.
Right? And I've always been fascinated with our cultural multiverses.
Right.
And unlike many cultures across the world, our culture has got a very unique place for it. Very unique, you know, ideas about it. It's not something dark. It is something which you just switch to. And I imbibe that into my design language and things that I do. So that is why a skull is not something, or a dead insect is not something which is icky or disgusting or something that you shouldn't touch, something unholy. We don't have that idea.
Okay.
Right? Our gods and goddesses sit on or wear, you know, garlands of skulls and bones.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
We have a god of them. Right? And he's a god and he's not something dark.
Right.
So why will we subscribe to something which kind of gives that color to something which is dead? Right?
Okay.
So that's why for me, a skull is something as beautiful as a lump of gold.
Okay.
If I can tell the right story, it can be even more precious than gold, because gold is available.
Correct.
A skull is something that I just can't go ahead and buy. So
correct.
I had to collect it. I probably went to like an old fort or an old building or a jungle and I found it. I have my entire story to tell to that skull. It belonged to something. There's a story there.
So I think I wouldn't be wrong if I said traveling with you is very scary. You'll go to the most haunted of the places where people generally don't go.
I'm a big, you know, horror buff. So I have chased ghosts all my life. But yeah, traveling with me is super interesting because I will surely make you see beauty in things that you will otherwise.
Okay, next time I'm going to check out all the haunted places across the world. Come. So when you are creating these masterpieces, how much of time and what all details that you get into and what patience level is also there? Let's talk about some of your designs and see how they cooperate.
Okay, so let's say we'll talk about this scorpion, which is completely made of watch parts.
Okay.
It has got silver. It has got wings from dead insects. and these two pincers are used to belong to my pet crawfishes, crayfishes, freshwater lobsters. So when freshwater lobsters, like snakes, they leave their old skin to grow into new ones. Okay, so every few weeks they will discard these old pincers which I used to collect, right, and see how they came handy when I made this. Right.
So you have silver.
Yeah.
And then you have...
These are watch parts.
These
particular watch parts belong to watches from the early 19th century, about 1810, 1820.
Wow.
They have amazing engraving done on them, you can see. So somebody used to sit and do these engravings by hand, spending days. And this will be scrapped, right? This belongs to a lady's watch, bracelet.
Yeah, bracelet. Right?
These gears and the small parts come from mechanical watches.
Wow.
The structure of it is completely like an architecture. It's made in, handcrafted in silver. This piece has over, I think, 80-85 unique handcrafted silver pieces, which are then weld together. And then see the, even the reverse part, see the rainbow green and blue iridescent scales. These are individually cut from beetle wings. So I had to sit down and cut pieces as small as 2 millimeter by 2 millimeter. To fit, to give that scale sort of look.
Like the real beetle.
Yeah, like real beetle wings. So something like this, and then there are Swarovski crystals on top, right? So something like this comes together from various sources, which tells my personal journey to various things. So right. See, you know so many things about me just by looking at this piece and hearing the story.
Right? I'm sure each piece is from a different zone altogether.
Yeah, absolutely.
So how much time does it take for you to collect all of these, and then how do you know, okay, what am I collecting for? Are you designing, sketching it in advance, or when you collect a lot of stuff and then you decide, okay, I'm going to make this?
It happens both ways. So for example, when I collected these, when I was keeping these, I didn't know what I will use it for. I just kept them. When I collected each of these individual pieces, I didn't know where I will use them. I just knew that genuinely, from a very authentic place, I love these things. You know, these are nature's creation. You and I won't be able to create this the way nature has created.
Oh no.
So there is value in it. There is intrinsic value in it. May not be a price. So that is how I see value in objects, and that is how I collect. Then design for me is something very spontaneous and something very organic. I create out of chaos, right? When I collected all these parts, I didn't know that I will use them to make this car, right? That to a flying car, right? So everything came from 100 different watches from different places in the world. This little velvet piece is from the interior that you see around you, right? So these were cut pieces which were left behind, right? So, you know, broken, thrown away metal, this little rubber bands, I never knew I'll use it to create this kind of a science fiction structure, right? So things are, you know, lying about all across, and out of just chaos, I start imagining something, okay, and it just comes together. Most of the times, I don't even make a sketch in advance, right? Only when I have started making it, I create like a scale drawing or just detail out the close-up that I want. Sometimes if I need my karigars to make a piece, that's when I sketch it out. But most of the times, it's like painting with, you know, paint and brush. You cannot explain to someone else how to really paint it. So either I'm making it or I have to be there to explain how it is to be done, how I'm actually visualizing it in my mind, you know. And everything comes out of that kind of a very chaotic place in my mind, which has got no... There is a sense that I can make out of it, right? But it's very difficult to explain that to someone else.
Correct. So when you're making a story, you have a masterpiece. You have an emotional connect to it and your experience into it. And then you've converted this into a business. Do you think the current generation is ready and open? Because you've been doing it for a decade now. I don't know if I'm right here, but the clientele that you must be having are the ones who can understand the radio, they can understand the watches coming from the generations. What about the generation today? How do you think they will understand and take this in the coming future?
So that's the most interesting part. You don't have to understand this. You need to feel.
Okay.
And feelings are there from 8 to 80.
Okay.
Once you grow in and you start having self-awareness, you start having feelings.
Okay.
And that's how we humans are geared.
Mm-hmm.
And we keep feeling unless we die.
Correct.
So that is what my goal is, to create products, to create objects out of feeling, to express the feeling.
Okay.
So there is no, you don't need to really understand where it is from. Those stories I am going to tell. That's how you and I are going to bond. For you to bond with my products, you just need to feel it.
Okay.
You need to have, I make products to inspire curiosity, to inspire a sense of feeling wow.
Okay.
Right? You don't need to understand how Taj Mahal was built to say wow.
Correct.
When you see for the first time. You don't need to understand why it was built.
Right.
Who built it? What is the politics behind it? Nothing.
I agree.
Don't need to understand that. Right?
Totally agree there. So, you are into jewelry, both men and women. That's your product line. You've been doing it now. Where do you see yourself in the next 5 years? What are your plans? I mean, this year has been a pain for everybody, but and like you said, every year you come up with something new.
Right.
So, what's in 21 for us?
So, this year, though it has been, it could have been really painful, and it has been painful for most of us. But you know, I set a goal for myself for the months of lockdown that I'll make 100 products in 100 days. Okay? Because as a creator, I know only one way of battling my demons of depression, challenging my insecurities. That is to actually go ahead and create something of value. That's how I add value to my life. Okay. There's no point talking and debating and discussing all this, because I feel it's God's grace on me that I can create something with my own hands. A lot of people don't have hands also.
Correct.
Right? So I utilize them to make 100 things in 100 days. It was an amazing journey, and creatively, I'm super satisfied. Business is a different discussion altogether. But I think I have done some of my life's best work during these trying times. And I'm super excited to see that what I'm going to do next year, even I don't know. Right? I know that I want to take my products out in the world so that other people can come and experience it in a larger scale, in a more intimate scale. So I know that I definitely want to do that. I want to create a space like that where people can come together, we can have some discussions and some storytelling over like a nice evening. I want to create a space like that, that's for sure. But what I'm going to create next is something even I've been waiting for to see. Turn that into something. So this was also, this is a this kind of a technique that was also invented by a German back in 1830.
Okay.
And this particular design was also made by a German artist back in 1930.
Okay.
Right? So we are almost in 2030.
Yeah.
10 years to go, but I would like 200 years of story of German ingenuity I tried to capture in one piece. So rather than throwing out that piece, I created this. So there is a little fire starter.
It's too cute.
Right? To light it up.
Mm-hmm.
And then the whole process is very, dramatic when it happens.
That really works.
Yeah. And this is like the aroma diffuser. A little bit of coffee beans in it. It's more of a storytelling piece.
What he's going to come up next year. But what we definitely know that he's created some amazing masterpieces. Be it whatever age you are, you need to visit him, you need to understand and see, hear from his side of the story, because each piece definitely has a lot to tell. Thank you so much, Abhishek, for sharing your experience with us. It was a pleasure talking to you.